please welcome our first guest, APTA's president and CEO, Mr. Paul Skatalis.
What's most important is that the people that are here, part of the APTA family, are what define APTA. And we are happy to be together.
Please join me in congratulating the 2019 Leadership APTA graduating class. All of you have a wonderful time. Can I hope to see you all next year?
This is truly an unprecedented situation.
Tonight, a dramatic spike in New York State's death toll from 385 to more than 500. Emergency rooms are swamped.
That could be one of my family members. That could be me.
COVID-19 can be characterized as a pandemic.
Those on the front lines are exhausted.
It's like a war zone.
Stay at home.
Stay home, stay safe.
Quite simply, stay at home.
COVID-19 situation has really been hammering our small businesses across the country.
We don't know from month to month where our income is going to come from.
They told me that they was going to fund me because I can no longer work.
I don't know what our future holds. I don't really want to think about it.
People had to kind of pivot, and so that's what we had to do.
Men and women are putting it on the line every day. And I've said this before, I mean, we're the first responders to the first responders.
The people that are giving you your COVID vaccines, those people take our buses and I need to take them to work.
I don't know if this is the day that I myself may go out and be infected, but I guess my courage is greater than my fear.
Well, I can definitely say I feel like a hero because I have been there through it all. We showed up every day and we kept it going.
All smiles aboard the MTA float from the essential workers who carried the city through the pandemic.
It's a great honor. I mean, you see all the people that turned out and all the workers that are here, you know, just we're all very appreciative.
Transportation workers are heroes, moving heroes, and we're grateful to each of them.
Now is the time to embrace the goals of climate responsibility, equity, and economic strength for the future.
Smart deployments that minimize inconvenience for riders and increases their confidence in mass transit.
If we can take technology, combine it with mass transit, we can create a totally new way for people to move around the city.
And now, please welcome APTA President and CEO, Paul Skatalis, and APTA Chair, Jeffrey Nelson.
How are we doing? Good morning and welcome to Transform. We are back. APTA is back, and we are thrilled to see you all again. Are we not, Jeff?
We are. With all the challenges we've endured since the spring of 2020, we're here today because of our support for one another and the unity of our industry. First and foremost, Paul, I want to thank you all for the sacrifices you made in the past 20 months and the efforts you have made to travel here this week.
You know, when we met in New York, more than 2 years ago, we had a great deal to look forward to. We were confident about bringing transformational change to public transportation. Never did we imagine the transformational change would be thrust upon us by a global pandemic. None of us want to relive the past year and a half. But think about what we've overcome, the challenges that we've met, the obstacles we conquered, the communities we saved.
Think about how much smarter, resourceful, innovative, efficient, safer, and more financially stable public transportation is today compared to where we were at in March 2020.
This is a special moment. It's a reunion. It's a new beginning. It's a call to action. And indeed, it's a celebration. And we have a lot to celebrate. On Friday night, Congress approved the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act. This is the $1.2 trillion, right? Did we hear that? $1.2 trillion bipartisan infrastructure package that we've all been working on to enact for years.
And the package also includes the new five-year surface transportation reauthorization with $107 billion for public transit, $102 billion for commuter rail, Amtrak, and other high-performance rail. An infrastructure and a new authorization of our transit program has been APTA's two biggest goals, and we got them both. Later today, we'll hear from our good friend and former APTA chair, Nuria Fernandez, and her role as FTA administrator, along with FRA deputy administrator, Amit Bose. And tomorrow, we'll be joined by Representative Peter DeFazio, chairman of the House Committee on Transportation Infrastructure, one of our biggest supporters.
You know, we also know that the pandemic brought new issues to the surface transportation challenges that we face. Climate change, racial and economic equity, bringing back riders, and new threats like cybersecurity risks. So for the next 3 days, we'll focus on what's next. The electrification of buses, procurement and supply chain issues, new technologies in customer information and fare collection, future ridership trends, and putting equity into action.
For our keynote speakers, we have a former astronaut and award-winning chef. They both have remarkable stories to tell. Tomorrow morning, we'll honor the industry's best of the best with APTA honors and awards ceremony. And then there's the EXPO.
The EXPO.
The EXPO.
More than 600 companies, 300,000 square feet of the latest products, services for public transportation. You'll be amazed, I'm sure, at what has been invented, updated, and brought to market since our last expo in 2017. 4 years ago for an APTA expo, we're long overdue.
So let's get on with connecting to the next, starting with our first guest. He has shown himself not only to be a supporter of public transit, but a leader who is committed to our issues. He grew up in a small Midwestern town like I did, so I feel we share many of the same values and a similar view of the world. He is the son of an immigrant, a Rhodes Scholar, and a former two-term mayor, a veteran of who was deployed in Afghanistan, and now he adds a moniker, a new father to that list.
You know, many of us had a chance to meet with him for the first time when APTA co-sponsored a forum for presidential candidates back in 2020. We were both there,
Las
Jeff.
Vegas.
Since the start of the Biden administration, we've had the honor to work with him and his team on a wide range of issues for our industry, and he has collected an incredibly talented team around him. He was not able to travel to Florida to be with us this week, but he very much wanted to send his best wishes to all of us, and for that we're grateful. Let's listen to the message from the United States Secretary of Transportation, Pete Buttigieg.
Thank you, President Skoutelis and Chair Nelson, for that introduction. And thanks for inviting me to speak to you today. I regret that I can't be with you in person, but I'm always grateful for the chance to address such committed leaders and champions of public transit. Earlier this fall, I got a letter from a middle school student in Georgia. And she wrote about how people in rural and low-income communities spend hours traveling to supermarkets just to get groceries for the week. And she wisely pointed out that expanding public transit is one of the best ways to eliminate food deserts and help everyone get healthy food for their families. Like millions of Americans, she understands the essential role that public transit plays and the importance of the dedicated workers in public transit. And that's never been more true than during these last 21 months. After more than a year of isolation, people everywhere have a renewed appreciation for just how important transit is. For our economy, of course, but also in terms of accessibility, equity, and the fight against climate change. Since we last spoke in May, funds in the American Rescue Plan that you fought so hard for have helped transit agencies around the country restore and expand service, prevent layoffs, and connect millions of Americans to vaccination sites. But in this pivotal moment, we know that it's not enough just to return to the past we knew. We have a once-in-a-century opportunity, and I believe an obligation, to reimagine our transportation systems for the future. We are on the cusp of delivering the President's Build Back Better agenda, which includes transformational investments in combating climate change, in healthcare, and in supporting families. And with the historic infrastructure legislation, we're going to make the largest investment in passenger rail since the creation of Amtrak itself, and the largest federal investment in public transit in our nation's history. We're talking about creating a new generation of good-paying jobs, building, driving, and maintaining buses and rail cars. We can create jobs for construction workers, building new businesses and affordable housing near transit lines, and jobs working at those new businesses for people who can now take the bus or train to work. And we're looking at jobs that will help us address the defining challenge of climate change. Our transportation sector is the economy's single largest contributor to greenhouse gas emissions. That also means that we get to be a huge part of the solution. Transit plays a vital role in meeting our domestic and international goals for reducing emissions. One of the best ways to do that is by making it easy, accessible, and affordable for people to get around without necessarily having to bring 2 tons of metal with them everywhere they go. That's why the President's infrastructure legislation includes nearly $6 billion to replace transit buses with clean, zero-emission vehicles. Already, we have seen transit agencies around the country pledge to convert their fleets to electric vehicles. We're doing everything that we can to speed that transition and to support you in your local leadership, including expanding our low and no-emission bus programs and prioritizing grant applications with a strong climate focus. We're also working to advance equity and accessibility in everything that we do. After all, we know that people of color are far less likely to own a car and far more likely to depend on public transit. And we know that 1 in 4 Americans has a disability. The unemployment rate for people with disabilities is twice as high as that it is for those who are not part of the disability community. And lack of access to transportation is one of the biggest reasons. The work that you do is critical to ensuring that people with disabilities have access to jobs and opportunities to contribute and to earn a good living. And we're committed to helping you do that good work, which is why the President's infrastructure plan includes $2.2 billion to make transit and paratransit more accessible. And it's why the FTA prioritizes grant applications that demonstrate a commitment to improving accessibility and that include local disability advocates in their planning. In the past year, I've visited communities like Chicago, Atlanta, Phoenix, and all around the country, places where local transit agencies are working to make transit more accessible and expand their service to historically underserved and overburdened neighborhoods. I've been inspired looking at the work that leaders like you around the country have done, working to ensure that people who rely on transit the most can better access jobs, schools, medical care, groceries, and affordable housing. And with the funds in the infrastructure deal, we will be able to support even more good efforts to connect riders with services and with opportunity across the country. From public transit to passenger rail, from equity to accessibility, from climate to jobs in the economy, we have a chance right now to make sure that America has the best transit systems in the world. Every time you enhance your service, you connect neighborhoods, you clean the air, you improve healthcare options, you bring people to work. You change lives, you shape communities, and ultimately, you help craft our country's future. From middle school students to seniors, the American people know why transit matters. And now we have a chance that only comes along once every few generations to build transit systems that work for all of them in new ways. Thank you for your excellent efforts, and I'm looking forward to working with you in the years ahead.
Now please welcome to the stage Orange County Mayor Jerry Demings.
Baby, it's a brand new day. Ain't no clouds hanging over me. Something doesn't feel Good morning, good morning. It is indeed my honor and privilege to welcome you here to the Orange County Convention Center. It was great to hear from Transportation Secretary Buttigieg, and we are all waiting to hear more about how the newly passed federal infrastructure legislation will apply to improving our nation's transportation system. I will take just a moment of personal privilege here. My wife is Honorable Congresswoman Val Butler Demings, and she had the opportunity this past Saturday morning, to vote on the infrastructure bill. I believe that we are on the precipice to a new era in transportation. This is a high priority for Central Florida. I get to serve here in Orlando, in Orange County, as the chair of the Central Florida Commuter Rail Commission and vice chair of the Central Florida Regional Transit Authority, our local transportation agency, better known as LINX. We're joined today by Mr. Jim Harrison, the CEO of LINX, who will be assisting you with this conference. Please join me in recognizing Jim Harrison. Much like many metropolitan communities around the nation, we are experiencing growing pains, which include both housing and transportation challenges here within this community. We hope to pass an infrastructure penny sales tax in November 2022 to provide a dedicated funding source to help solve many of our transportation challenges. With more than 1.4 million people in Orange County alone, we need a mass transportation system that lives up to the world-class community that is Orange County. Over the next several days, I look forward to hearing from industry professionals as they showcase technology, products, and services that will better serve our communities now and into the future. During your stay, I hope you take the time to visit our world-class hospitality venues, exciting theme parks, arts, sports, and cultural attractions. There is truly something for everyone to do here in Orange County. To celebrate this significant conference and expo in our community, I would like to recognize APTA with a proclamation. The proclamation reads, "Whereas the American Public Transportation Association is a nonprofit international association of more than 1,300 public and private sector member organizations. And whereas APTA is the only association in North America that represents all modes of public transportation, including bus, paratransit, light rail, commuter rail, subways, waterborne services, and intercity and high-speed passenger rail. And whereas APTA's Transform Conference and Expo 2021 is public transit's premier showcase of technology, products, and services. And whereas APTA's Transform Conference and Expo 2021 will bring 10,000 transit professionals to the Orange County Convention Center. And whereas APTA's Transform Conference and Expo is the only event where the entire transportation industry converges to learn, share, and network. And whereas APTA's members and fellow transit professionals are more eager than ever to reconvene for an unprecedented reunion full of exciting experiences and enlightening interactions. Now, therefore, I, Jerrell Demings, by virtue of the authority vested in me as Orange County Mayor, do hereby proclaim the week of November 7th through 13th, 2021, as Public Transit Week in Orange County, Florida, and extend a warm welcome and best wishes for a successful conference and exposition to all members, attendees, and guests. Done and ordered this 8th day of November 2021. Thank you for giving me a few minutes of your time this morning. And at this time, I'm going to ask your chair, Mr. Paul Skatelis, to come forward at this time to receive the proclamation.
Mr. Mayor, thank you, sir. We appreciate your comments. Let's line up right here. Okay, great. Mr. Mayor, thank you so much.
Thank you,
we appreciate your leadership and all that what you're doing. Please know that APTA and our entire industry is standing behind you, ready to support you as you undertake your initiative in 2022 for a new infrastructure investment for public transportation.
Thank you.
Thanks for being with us. You know, as we know from the work that we do, it takes real leadership, and Mayor Demings is providing that here in Central Florida. You heard him say about the initiative that they're going to be undertaking in 2022. They were all set to go in 2020. And of course, the pandemic changed everything. But they're back on track, and we're eager to assist the mayor and the entire community to achieve its ultimate goals that will address public transportation. Well, now it's my great pleasure to introduce our host city, the host of our transit system at Lynx, Jim Harrison. Jim is the CEO there. I have known Jim for many, many years. When I worked here in Central Florida, in Orlando, as the Lynx CEO many years ago, Jim was a senior executive in Orange County. And we had an occasion to work together quite a bit during those years. Well, 3 years ago, Jim stepped in an interim capacity and now is the permanent CEO at Lynx. And he really has made a difference. He has stabilized their operations, their budget, and got them on a path for continued growth. And of course, as you've heard, they have growth in their future, in their plans. So he comes to the job with a great background in engineering and in law. He's well prepared for the challenges he's going to be facing and providing the leadership that he does for Central Florida and for Lynx. So let's please welcome Jim Harrison. Welcome, Jim.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you for those very kind words. And good morning, everyone, and welcome. Welcome here to Central Florida. We are so glad to have this important conference here this week. And it's so good to be getting back together in person for what seems like forever. I have a few other comments, but before I go on, I'd like to bring up a brief message from our Lynx board chairman and the mayor of the city of Orlando, Mayor Buddy Dyer.
Hello, I'm Orlando Mayor Buddy Dyer, and I also have the pleasure of serving as the chairman of the Lynx board of directors. We're excited to welcome the public transportation industry for APTA's Transform Conference and EXPO here in the City Beautiful. While you're here, we hope you'll take advantage of all that Orlando has to offer, from our world-class venues and dining options, theme parks, and amazing weather. Thank you for visiting, and have a great time at your conference.
Mayor Dyer could not be here with us in person this morning. He sends his regrets, but he will be participating in other discussions and panel conversations here at this conference this week. And I certainly want to express my sincere appreciation and gratitude to both Mayor Jerry Demings and Mayor Buddy Dyer for their leadership. We are very, very fortunate here in this community to have strong leaders who are also great champions of public transit. No one could have predicted the landscape of these last 2 years, but as a region, as an industry, we all rallied together doing what we do best, safely moving our communities forward. Ridership is slowly moving back to pre-pandemic levels. Business, travel, and restaurant use is picking up. But more importantly, these last 2 years have allowed us to reimagine how we are delivering our services in the 21st century. And we are here to share that information with each other. As you enjoy the next several days here at the conference, please do not hesitate to ask any of the Lynx employees that you see for any assistance that you might need. We have some great dedicated staff here, and they're here to help. From all of us here at Lynx, we certainly want you to enjoy your visit, and please come back soon. Let me close with a little local interest story, Paul alluded to some history here. And the Orlando Sentinel is our newspaper of regional distribution. If you're from the area, you're very, very familiar with that. So in 1998, a story in the Orlando Sentinel read as follows. He may have been one of the highest profile transit bosses in the country. He arrived in 1991, inheriting a transit agency that few people could name and even fewer rode. So he did TV commercials, spoke at chicken dinners, and painted his fleet in decidedly un-bus-like colors like pink and teal. By the time he left in 1997, Lynx was well known in Central Florida, and ridership levels had doubled. He was profiled in the Wall Street Journal, and Lynx had been named one of the top transit systems in the country. So supporters credit him with breathing life into a dead bus system. And of course, you all know who I'm talking about, so please join me in welcoming back to the podium former Lynx CEO, Paul Skatelis. Have a great week here, everyone.
Well, you can see Lynx has great leadership in place in Jim Harrison. And you know, it takes so much to put on one of these conferences, especially attached to an expo. So the leadership that Jim, the Lynx organization, have provided to us over these many months as we begin to plan and now to execute this has been just unfathomable. Jim, thank you very much for your personal leadership and for the leadership of the Lynx team to get us to where we are here today. So as you can well imagine, in that preparation, not only for your host system, as we have in the support of Lynx, we're also appreciative of our business members. They really do step up to provide us with resources in the form of sponsorships and the like that make these events possible. And I'm very pleased this morning to recognize AECOM, a generous sponsor of this opening session, a continuing generous sponsor of APTA over many, many years. So with us this morning to offer a few remarks is Diane Cowan, AECOM's Senior Vice President and Director of Global Transit. Diane, please come forward.
It is so good to see all of you. After way too many years, too long years, AECOM and I are really excited to reconnect with all of you and to welcome you to APTA Transform and to EXPO. So at AECOM, we're really excited too this week to re-engage and reconnect with our clients, our friends, myself with my leadership APTA 2018 team, and my colleagues and clients. So, you know, some of the things that we want to discuss is, one, we want to celebrate, of course, the bipartisan infrastructure bill. So hopefully we'll all be toasting to that soon. Additionally, we really want to talk about what's next in public transportation, and how at AECOM, we're helping our employees, our communities, and our clients thrive in this ever-changing world. So over the next few years, we look forward to working with all of you, hand in hand, to deliver a better world.
Thank you, Diane, and thank you, AECOM, for, again, your special, generous sponsorship of APTA and this conference and all you do for our industry. Well, what we've been through, right? When COVID threatened our mission, our work, our livelihoods, and even our lives, the public transportation industry showed up. Didn't just show up, but we showed up big, in a big way. As Glenn Tolbert said in the opening video, if you caught that, transit workers were the first responders to the first responders. I know there are people in the audience who suffered and sacrificed, who worked day and night to keep their systems operating, and we applaud you, and who put fear and doubt aside to meet unprecedented challenges every day. I'm proud that our association was able to deliver the tools to support and the resources needed to meet our members' needs during this time. Of course, our first responsibility was to secure emergency funding to keep public transit operating, and we did just that. In three separate legislative packages, we secured nearly $70 billion in emergency funding for public transportation. Congratulations. These funds were used to avoid layoffs and furloughs, to purchase protective gear and safety equipment, and to keep buses operating on the road and our trains on the tracks. But APTA did more than just deliver dollars. We launched a health and safety commitments program to help agencies protect passengers and employees from the spread of COVID-19 and to restore riders' trust. We hosted weekly conference calls and roundtable discussions to coordinate the responses to the pandemic, to share information and to reassure one another that we would fight this and win this fight together. We provided critical information via the COVID Hub on the APTA website, with the latest guidance, research, and best practices from all around the world. And as the virus evolved and needs became more complex, we created a new set of webinars and online tools and virtual events to help address specific COVID-related challenges. As our transit systems and businesses led the way through the pandemic and successfully maneuvered challenge after challenge, we've seen ridership grow steadily. Couple examples. In February of this year, ridership was only 34% of what it was at the same time pre-pandemic. By May, that number had climbed to 41%. By this past July, it was 53%, and as of last week, ridership had reached 63% of what it was in late October of 2019. While we're not where we need to be, we are making progress. We are in a much stronger position than we were during the worst of the pandemic. For example, ridership for the second quarter of this year, 2021, were 85% higher compared to the same period in 2020. So we continue to make significant progress on the ridership front. I know that's important to all of us. It's one of the important indicators, just one of the important indicators of what we do. Though the pandemic may have shut down much of the economy, it did not stop APTA from fulfilling its promise to serve you, our members. And this morning, the accomplishment certainly that we're most proud of is the passage of the $1.2 trillion infrastructure package. It saw a new 5-year surface transportation authorization contained in that that provides dramatic funding increases for public transit and for passenger rail. The importance of this achievement for our industry just cannot be overstated. Our entire membership, agencies, business members have worked together closely over the last few years to produce this impressive outcome. This portends a promising future for public transportation. Tomorrow, we'll release a new report on how transit agencies have responded to the pandemic and how they're preparing for the future. It will show how demographic, employment, and travel trends are likely to change in the coming years and even decades. It also includes recommendations to ensure equitable access to mobility. And it's yet one more example of how we have dealt with the pandemic and how the pandemic has changed us. You know, as terrible as the virus has been and the toll that it's taken on our nation and really the world, It has shown our resilience and adaptability as an industry and certainly as an association as well. It's given us a new appreciation for the communities we serve and the essential role that we play in their viability and vitality. It has revealed how important public transportation is to mitigate the effects of climate change. It prompted us to be flexible and be resourceful, to experiment, to focus not on operating our systems as we always have, but rather on solving new problems, no matter how difficult or unforeseen. It forced us to face our transportation industry's own shortcomings when it comes to racial equity and fair access to mobility. And it made us reevaluate and appreciate the time with our families and our friends and our neighbors, and of course, our APTA family. That's why we're here this week, to prove that something as painful and as devastating and yes, as scary as COVID-19 has actually made us, in turn, it's made us stronger and more courageous. There will be many, many books written about the lessons learned from the pandemic, but for APTA and for the public transportation industry, it really comes down to this. We prevailed over the crises and we proved our value. Our eyes are now on what comes next. And all the lessons we learned these past 2 years will help us to create a successful future. You know, the young poet Amanda Gorman, if you saw her, who spoke at President Biden's inaugural this past January, perhaps said it the best. There's always light if only we are brave enough to see it, if only we are brave enough to be it. So, my friends, our communities and the world, they're counting on us, on you, on us together, to be brave enough. We know that we can and that we must shape the future. It's now. Let's begin here, this week at APTA Expo and Transform, to build this new future together. Thank you. Well, now it is my pleasure to introduce the leader who will help us define this new future together and the new opportunities that lie ahead. He's someone that I've known for many, many years as a colleague. He seamlessly assumed the role of APTA chair when Nuria Fernandez was selected to become the head of the Federal Transit Administration earlier this year. Of course, we couldn't be more proud of Nuria. He's known to many of you as the head of the Rock Island Metropolitan Mass Transit District, known as Metrolink. Here's a brief introduction to our dear friend and colleague, Jeff Nelson.
Jeff Nelson's career is proof that excellence comes from loving what you do. But like most successful relationships in life, Jeff's passion for public transportation wasn't so much chosen as it was nurtured by people he met by chance. Back in the early 1980s, Jeff was a successful up-and-coming insurance broker for large institutions. The Rock Island County Metropolitan Mass Transit District, known as Metrolink, was one of his clients. It didn't take long before people began to notice the young 20-something's people skills and innate organizational abilities. Jeff was offered a business development position at Metrolink. 2 years later, at age 26, Jeff became the youngest transit GM in the country. It was the start of a remarkable love affair with public transportation. Under his leadership, Metrolink was named APTA's Outstanding Public Transportation System. And the agency was the recipient of the FTA's State Leadership Award, the NAACP Business Image Award, and numerous community and civic accolades. Jeff was an early adopter of alternative fuels back in 2002. Today, most of the agency's buses are powered by compressed natural gas, and a third are zero-emission vehicles. Jeff is helping to guide our industry into a new and different future. In looking back on a career devoted to improving the quality of life for all, it's apt to say that public transit chose Jeff before Jeff chose public transit. And we are all better for it.
Please welcome again our good friend and colleague, APTA Chair Jeff Nelson. Let's get it loud. Let's get it loud. Turn the music All right, man.
Take it easy.
Thank you, buddy. Thank you, Paul. There's some incredible energy in this room. Is it the 20 months of pent-up angst that we all have, or is it that $1.2 billion infrastructure bill? All I seem to get is these polite golf claps. $1.2 trillion. Let's wake up. I want to begin by recognizing the heroes of public transit, the ones we know by name and the ones we never met. The men and women who put service before their own safety. We are here forever indebted to their individuals. So please give me a round of applause for their hard work. After more than 35 years in public transportation and having this opportunity to serve all of you as the role of APTA chair, this is truly the high point of my career. I'm standing on this stage today rather than managing an insurance company because of the remarkable people at Metrolink in Moline, Illinois, and the countless individuals in our industry who taught me how public transportation can change lives. I'd like to thank all of those who have shared this journey with me. COVID-19 just didn't bring new challenges. It accelerated trends that were already underway. It exposed things like changing travel patterns and riders' preferences, limited access in our underserved neighborhoods, questions about who owns the curb, and the need for a broader funding base, and an incredibly important role public transportation can play in social, environmental, and economic issues. The good news is the innovations we saw emerging before COVID-19 have helped us prepare for the past year and is what is still yet to come. Think about it. What so many transit agencies have been able to do in the last 20 months, redesigning transit networks, adding flexible routes and schedules, investing in resilient, clean, energy-efficient infrastructure, advancing the discussion how we meet the diverse needs of our community, and employing new technology to enhance the health, safety, and security of our passengers and transit employees. These are just some of the actions that you've already begun to take that will help redefine the future of public transportation. The pandemic brought on some old and new priorities into much clearer focus. When COVID-19 threatened to shut down our transit systems, our agencies embraced the new mobility concepts, creating a greater connectivity among modes, transitioning from being a provider of mobility to a provider of managing mobility, making transit more convenient, flexible, and customer-focused. These are the new mobility goals that we're all familiar with, but they're going to require us to focus and take advantage of our new funding. It's why the infrastructure package will be so important to the future of transit. Two other key priorities that have taken center stage at APTA and in our industry, climate change and racial equity. We know transportation sector generates the largest share of greenhouse gas emissions in the United States. We also know that public transportation is leading the transition away from older fossil fuels. Our industry has a positive story to tell. So let's tell that story. We are a critical part of this solution. We have a leadership role to play on one of the most important issues of our time. Our work is to advance equity must be acknowledged by our shortcomings of our past so they don't become part of our future. APTA has made diversity, equity, and inclusion a priority. And I'm so proud that the Racial Equity Action Plan has been endorsed by our APTA Board of Directors. This week, we will launch a racial equity commitment program, a roadmap for how agencies, regardless of your size or experience, can advance racial equity. The pilot offers a safe, collective learning environment open to all APTA members. I encourage you, your organization, to sign on to this program. Our work on these issues is getting a big boost this week. The Transform Conference program includes a session later this afternoon on making commitment to racial equity. We have presentations on electric bus fleet technology, lowering carbon emissions, and there are discussions about the innovations in new mobility. We have an opportunity, we have a responsibility right here and right now to reimagine the future by focusing on these new priorities. Whether it's a post-COVID economic recovery, investing in our new or delivering mobility ideas, mitigating the effects of climate change, or advancing greater equity and access to all these opportunities, public transportation is the essential element for progress in all these issues. In times of uncertainty, survival often depends on one's ability to process new information, and we've had plenty of that over the last 20 months. We need to think differently. We need to be flexible. We need to be bold. We need to be courageous. There is nothing more fundamental to the human spirit than the need to be mobile. It's the force that sparks our imagination. It opens pathways to life-changing opportunities. Mobility propels the promise of prosperity, personal freedom, and a quality of life. America needs to move, and we need to act. Connecting to what we know is next is what we must do, can do, and will do. Thank you for joining us today. I look forward to seeing you all at the Expo, and have a great rest of this week.
Well, I also want to thank all of our presenters and speakers this morning. They all have been terrific, and we are appreciative of them joining us. In a moment, I am going to invite our APTA officers and other team members to join me on the stage. But first, we have a very special treat for you, a joyful treat. Performing a song that is dedicated to all public transit workers, I'm pleased to present to you Orlando's own, the Joyful Noise Choir.
We can hide away in daylight. We go undercover, wait out the sun.
There's a secret side in plain sight. Where the streets are empty, that's where we run.
Everyday people do everyday things, but I can't be one of them.
I know you hear me now. We are a different kind. We can do anything. We could be heroes. We could be heroes.
Me and you.
Heroes. We could be heroes.
Ooh.
Heroes. We could be heroes.
Me and you.
Heroes. We could be love and light. Love and light. Heroes. Love and light. Love and light. Heroes.
Everybody's got the power. They don't see it cause they don't understand.
We gon' run and run for hours. You and me, we got the world in our hands.
Everyday people do everyday things, but I can't be one of them.
You hear me now, we are a different kind. We can do anything. We could be heroes.
Ooh.
Heroes. We could be heroes.
Me and you.
Heroes. We could be heroes.
Ooh.
Heroes. We could be heroes.
Me and you.
Heroes. We could be love and light. Love and light. Heroes.
Be heroes.
Love and light.
Love and light.
Love and light. We could be heroes. We could be heroes.
Me and you.
Heroes.
All we're looking for is love and a little light. Love and a little light. We could be.
All we're looking for is love and a little light. Love and a little light.
Love and a little light.
We could be
heroes.
We could be heroes.
Me and you.
What did you think of that, guys? Huh? Unbelievable.
Thank you.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Such talents. In fact, it was spectacular. I was dancing back there, almost forgetting to come out. You guys are wonderful. What a perfect way this is to open our Expo 2021. So now I would like to invite to join me on the stage our APTA Administrator Nuria Fernandez, Jeff Nelson, and the APTA team. Let's come forward. Oh my goodness, these look menacing. Wow. Do you dare put these in my hands? Not sure. Look at that. This weighs a ton. Have you ever seen scissors like this? Here we go. So let's tilt that back a little bit. Tilt it just a little bit further back. Hey, woo! Expo 2021 is officially open. Please come with us now to the exhibition hall and you will get another treat, a final song. So we will see you in a few minutes over at Expo. Thank you all for making this the opening session so very, very special. Thank you. Jim. Thank you.